So welcome to this course module of communication engineering. So in the last lecture, we have already seen the SSB modulation as a hybrid AM and phase modulation. We have already seen what is free envelope and what is complex envelope. So that we have already seen, and their corresponding equations we have already seen. Okay. So now in the today's lecture, we have to look at about the generation of the SSB AC signal. So that discussion we have to make today. So basically, as we have seen in the case of AM and DSB AC, we are having different kind of methods for generating the AM, conventional AM signal, and DSB AC signal. In a similar fashion, for generation of the SSB AC signal, we are generally having two different methods which are popularly known. Okay, so the first method that we have for generation of the SSB AC signal is frequency discrimination method. Okay, so let's begin how this frequency discrimination method can be used for generation of the SSB AC signal. So as you can see that in this picture, in the frequency discrimination method, I am using a single stage generation. I will tell you what is the single stage generation and two stage generation. So first you try to understand this scheme. Okay, so as we know that how to generate the SSB AC signal, means DSB AC signal. Okay, so to generate the DSB AC signal, what we do is we are taking the masses signal. Okay, first we are taking the masses signal, and that masses signal has to be multiplied with the appropriate carrier signal. Okay, and then this has to be multiplied, and then this product will be passed through a appropriate band pass filter to select one of the side bands. Okay, for example, if you see in this case, okay, we have one masses signal. Okay, I have taken this particular masses signal whose frequency spectrum is known to be shown as in this particular picture. Okay, so I have taken this particular masses signal number of times. So in this case, what we can see is our masses signal that we have taken is our multi-tone signal whose maximum frequency is FM, and it is starting right from the frequency F equals to zero. Fine. So that is our masses signal. So now when we have this masses signal, and when we are going to multiply it with the carrier signal AC cos 2 pi FCT, we know that we are going to get the double sideband suppressed carrier modulated wave. So if we do that, we know that after multiplying it, we are going to get a spectrum like, let us suppose that this VT represents the multiplication of the two. So the Fourier spectrum of this time domain expression VT will be something look like this. Okay, so we have already discussed it so many times. So basically what happens is the masses signal spectrum will be shifted around the carrier frequency. So this is what we can see from this slide. So this is this has been shifted to this carrier frequency FC. Okay, around the carrier frequency FC, and we know that because we are suppressing the carrier will not be present. Okay, so we can see that we are having this spectrum in which this spectrum is varying from FC to FC plus FM, and it will also having FC minus FM. Okay, so now after having this particular spectrum of the double sideband suppressed carrier signal after the output of the product modulator, here we have the product modulator, then now, if we want to get the SSB AC signal based on our requirement, whether we want to retain the upper sideband or we want to retain the lower sideband, we need to have a appropriate band pass filter of particular pass band. So let us suppose if we want to retain the upper sideband, we can see that in the double sideband suppressed carrier scheme, we generally have two sidebands, upper sideband, and then we are having the lower sideband. So suppose that if we want to retain the upper sideband, okay, we just want to retain the upper sideband, and if we want to means remove the lower sideband, then this type of ideal filter characteristics is required. Here you can see that we are having the ideal characteristics of a band pass filter in which if we wish to just retain the upper sideband, we need to have a filter whose frequency response will have a pass band in between FC to FC plus FM, so that only upper sideband can be passed through the filter and the lower sideband frequencies can be filtered out. So this is the requirement of our ideal band pass filter. Okay, then if you want to retain the lower sideband, then obviously what we need to have is we need to have a frequency response of the ideal band pass filter shown in this particular picture. Okay, so in this range what we can see that we are having its pass band. So this particular filter, band pass filter, is having its pass band between frequency fc minus fm to fc, and similarly this upper sideband will be rejected. This upper sideband will not be passed through the our band pass filter. So now what we can see from this picture, we can have one idea is that basically when we have any double sideband suppressed carrier signal, to generate the SSBAC signal by using the frequency discrimination method, what we need is we need to have a appropriate band pass filter with a certain pass band. Okay, and then it will depend on what kind of signal we have. Okay, and then only we can pass it through the appropriate band pass filter to get the SSBAC signal. Fine. So it is completely depending on the pass band of the band pass filter that will decide whether we are want to get the USB modulated signal or LSB modulated signal. Now, one point that I want to emphasize here is that if you see this message signal that I have taken in this case, okay? So in this case, what we can see is in this particular spectrum, the spectrum is varying right from the 0 to FM, right? That means this particular message signal that we have taken for our example, okay, this is not having spectral null around the DC. So what does it mean to say the spectral null around the DC? Okay, so basically when frequency f equals to zero, we say that it is a DC signal because DC don't have any frequency, right? So whenever there is a no frequency component around f equals to zero, then it is generally called as no spectral null is found in the message signal. But in this case, if you see, basically in this case, what we can see is there is a frequency component which is available at f equals to zero. That's why we have defined m0. Okay, so basically there is no spectral null, fine, around the DC. So what we can see is this particular message signal that we have taken is actually significantly containing all the frequency component right from zero up to FM, and after that there is no frequency component. So now you just try to understand a very important concept that whenever there is no spectral null around the DC, then ideal filtering is required. Fine. Why we are saying that ideal filtering is required? Because we want to just pass one of the sideband. Okay, we just want to pass one of the sideband completely, and we want to completely remove the other sideband. Fine. And what we can see that there is no gap between the sidebands. We can see that there is upper sideband and there is a lower sideband, but in between there is no gap between these two sidebands. So when there is no gap between the two sidebands, the ideal filtering is the only solution. Fine, we cannot go for the practical filters. So we need to have an ideal filter, and we know that we cannot design ideal filters. Fine. So this is one of the practical implications that we have to understand while generating the SSBAC signal using the frequency discrimination method. So now we try to understand that what happens if there is a spectral null around the DC. Okay, now you try to recall that when I told you about the different message signals, I told you that we are having different message signal like voice signal, we are having audio signals, we are having video signals. So if you remember, I told you that in the audio signals and video and voice signals, basically our voice signal is varying from 300 hertz to how much? 300 hertz to 3.4 or 3.1 kilohertz, okay? And if you see audio signals, audio signal is varying from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So now try to see and understand this concept very well. So basically what I'm trying to say is that, let us suppose if I take the example of the voice signal, okay? So whatever the example that I have taken in the last slide, okay, that particular signal does not have any spectral null around the DC, okay? Now, if you see this particular massive signal empty, which is nothing but our human voice spectrum, okay? This is the spectrum for our human voice signals, right? So it is varying from 300 hertz to 3.1 kilohertz or 3.4 kilohertz, depending on the various books, okay? So basically you will find this bandwidth will not greater than 3.5 kilohertz, okay? So if you see this spectrum, we have already seen this spectrum, okay? What we can see is its lower frequency is up to 300 kilohertz. And there is no frequency components will be available in the human voice signal in between 0 to 300 hertz. This is a very important concept, right, to understand this, fine? So when we have this type of massive signal, for example, if I have this type of massive signal in which there are no frequency component in between 0 to 300 hertz, now what we can say that this particular massive signal is having some spectral null around the DC. What is the spectral null? There is no frequency components available around the f equals to zero, fine? So this is our vertical line, which is nothing but our f equals to zero. And around this f equals to zero, we do not have any frequency component, okay? So basically from 0 to 300 hertz, we do not have any frequency component. Now you try to see if we take this as a massive signal, in the previous case, okay, in the previous slide. So if we have taken this as a massive signal, then when we multiply this particular massive signal with our carrier, what will happen? This carrier will, this massive signal's spectrum will be shifted around the carrier frequency. So let us suppose that I am taking the carrier frequency as equals to 1 megahertz, for example, fine? So as we said that in the DSPAC signal, there will be no carrier frequency, but this frequency spectrum is going to shift it around the carrier frequency FC. So let us say if it is 1000, then what we can have is we will be having this type of a spectrum. Okay, this type of a spectrum. So here you can see that I have marked the 1000 kilohertz frequency here, and then around this 1000 kilohertz frequency, this spectrum has to be shifted, okay? So here it will be, if it is 300 hertz, how it can be written in the kilohertz? It can be written as 0.3 kilohertz. So I can write this point as 1000.3 kilohertz. This can be written as 1003.1 kilohertz. And similarly, you can also calculate the midpoint of this particular frequency. So that will be coming out as 1001.7 kilohertz. So similarly, we can also calculate these points, right? It is very easy to calculate. So try to do this one, you will be getting 999.7 kilohertz, and here it is 996.9 kilohertz. So if you see this spectrum, remember that I told you that whenever we plot the spectrum should be a double-sided spectrum, okay? Means we have to plot in the positive frequency axis as well as onto the negative frequency axis. Okay, so onto both the axes, we have to plot the symmetrical plot of this particular frequency response. But just for the space is not there too much, so I have just plotted only the positive part. Okay, so you remember that if you want to plot it completely, you just extend this line and again take the mirror image of this particular spectrum. That will be your complete spectrum of the this particular DSBAC signal when we are taking this particular massive signal as a message. Okay, so this will be our spectrum. Now try to see the difference from the previous slide. So what was the difference? If you see here, we have this particular thing is our upper sideband. Okay, so whatever be the frequency component greater than the 1000 megahertz, that will be our upper sideband. So this particular frequency component is our upper sideband, and here we have the lower sideband. Now, if you see what is the difference between these two sidebands, okay, available means what is the gap, frequency gap between these two transition bands, means two sidebands, means upper sideband and the lower sideband, then you will find that this is around 600 hertz. Why it is 600 hertz? Because there is a gap between this this particular message itself. So here it is 300 hertz, and again it is minus 300 hertz. So what is the total gap in between? It is around 600 hertz. So the same gap will also exist when we perform the modulation. So once we do the modulation in the modulated wave DSBSC signal, what we will find that there will be a spectral gap between the upper sideband and the lower sideband, and that gap is around 600 hertz. Okay, if you see from the previous slide, okay, here you can see that there was no gap. Okay, there was no gap. This is our upper sideband and this one is our lower sideband. So because of there is no gap, we need to have an ideal band pass filter. Okay, now what we can see from this picture is, if you understood this one, okay, if you understood this one, now you try to understand the practical filter frequency response of band pass filter. So this is our practical filter, in which we will be having a certain central frequency F naught, okay, a certain central frequency, and then we will be having a certain pass band. Okay, you remember that generally we will be considering the pass band between the two 3 dB cutoff frequencies, fine. So here we have the flat region, and after that we are having this point like F3 and F2, which will be our 3 dB cutoff frequencies for the band pass filter. This is the lower 3 dB cutoff frequency of the practical band pass filter, and this will be the upper 3 dB cutoff frequency of the practical band pass filter. So now this will become our pass band, fine. This will become our pass band. Now, as you can see in the previous slide, I have taken this response. Okay, this is called as the brick wall approximation. Okay, so we have just taken like up to this. This is a flat response, and then the response is directly coming to the zero. Okay, so this type of response does not exist in the practical filter. There will be a certain transition or roll off factor. Okay, there will be a certain transition band. So it cannot directly go to zero after a certain frequency, but it will take some amount of frequency in which this frequency response, magnitude of the frequency response, will decrease gradually. Okay, it will decrease gradually. So this is what we can see in this picture, that this response have started decreasing gradually, and after a certain 3 dB fall, this fall will be rapidly happening. Okay, so here it is happening very rapidly. Okay, the roll off or the rate by which this gain of the filter is decreasing is very much high, and then it will enters into the stop band. Okay, so this is the practical filter response. Okay, it cannot directly go from pass band to stop band. You remember that. If you see in the previous slide, what we have done is we have taken, this is our pass band, and directly we have the stop band. Okay, here again we have the stop bands, but the same thing cannot be happening in the practical filters. The practical filters will have a certain transition bands. Okay, so what we mean to say that the transition bands, within this band, the gain of this filter is sufficiently high. You remember that the gain of the filter is sufficiently high, and therefore whatever be the frequency component that will fall within this transition band will also be allowed to pass with a little bit attenuation, that you try to understand, fine. So we have to take care about this transition band. Remember that we have to take care about this transition band, because in all the practical filters, we must have the pass band, we must have the transition band, and we will having a stop band. Okay, there will be no ideal responses. Okay, and therefore we have to take care about the transition band. Now there is a rule of thumb for filter designing. What is that rule of thumb for filter designing is, see, this TB represents the transition band of this filter. Okay, so basically what we are saying, that a filter can only be designed, okay, a filter can only be designed if its transition band is greater than 1% of its central frequency. Remember that. If transition band for this filter is greater than 1% of its central frequency, then only such filters can be designed. If there is a need that the transition band should be less than 1%, then it is not possible to design the filter, okay, practically. So what we are saying, that a transition band of the filter should be greater than 1% of the central frequency of the band pass filter. So if you considering this particular example. Okay, so now what we did is we have taken this massive signal which is having some spectral null around the DC, and then we are generating a DSBAC signal. Now after generating the DSBAC signal, what we need to have is we need to generate a particular we need to select one of the sideband, either upper sideband or a lower sideband. So what we need to do is we have to use one band pass filter of appropriate pass band so that we will be able to select only one of the sidebands, and other sideband can be rejected. For example, if we wish to do USB modulation, so how it can be done? Basically, we have to select this portion and we have to reject this particular portion. So now let us suppose if we are taking the carrier frequency equals to FC equals to 1 megahertz. I have already explained these will be the frequency components values. Okay. After having this, we need to have a particular filter. Okay. So that filter will have a certain frequency response. So let us suppose this is our band pass filter and we are having this particular frequency response of the band pass filter. Now, this particular USB has to fall within the pass band of the band pass filter, and there will be a certain central frequency of the band pass filter. So you try to calculate what should be the central frequency of the particular band pass filter. So I have calculated. You can also calculate very easily because this particular frequency 1001.7 is falling within the center of this particular massive signal. So you can just try to calculate what will be the center. I hope you will be able to do, and you will be getting the answer is 1001.7 kilohertz. Fine. So at this frequency, at this central frequency, we need to design the bandpass filter. So once we will be designing a bandpass filter at this particular frequency 1001.7, what we can do is we can calculate if this will be the central frequency, what will be the transition band if we take 1% of this. So basically, central frequency of this band pass filter for USB extraction would be 1001.7 kilohertz, and then the required minimum transition band, okay, as per this central frequency of this band pass filter will be 1% of this, that will be 10.017 kilohertz. Try to remember this, okay? Plotted like this, okay? So you might be confused because this transition band, it seems like the filter designing is possible, but no, because the required transition band is 10.017 kilohertz, and here you can see that the gap between this upper sideband and the lower sideband is just around 600 hertz. So available transition band is around 600 hertz, okay? But the required minimum transition band is 10.017 kilohertz. That means this particular arrangement may not be able to filter out the upper sideband. You remember that, okay? Because this is a single stage generation by using the frequency discrimination method. Because of the implication of the designing of the practical bandpass filters, we cannot separate out one of the sidebands, okay? Why? Try to understand again, because the required minimum transition band by following this rule of thumb for filter designing, that will be 10.017 kilohertz. But here it is, available transition band is 600 hertz. So if we take a filter, okay, its transition band will not like this. It will go something like this. Okay, it will go something like this. So here again, I can take one pen. Okay, I can explain you. Let us suppose if we choose this 10.17, then it will be something like this, okay? It will go something like this, okay? And obviously, a certain portion of this LSB is also going to be selected, okay? If you do it carefully, because here it is just, you can see here it is 1000. So after 1000, if you go up to 10 kilohertz, so I hope it is going like this also. Okay, it may go like this also. So there may be a chances that your entire upper sideband and lower sideband both is going to be selected. And that time you could not design such practical filters that will be able to separate out the only one of the sideband. So why it is happening? Because of the available transition band. Okay, whatever the available transition band that we have, it is just around 600 hertz, but the minimum required transition band is 10.017 kilohertz as per this particular rule of thumb for filter designing. So now you try to understand, if this is the case, okay, if this is the case, then what will be the solution? How this like frequency discrimination method can be used for means generating the SSBSC signal. So single stage generation generally not followed. We can generate the SSBSC signal by frequency discrimination method by having two stage generation. So now try to understand what is the concept, okay, in the two stage generation. So generally what we do is, in the two stage generation, we are taking the message signal MT, okay, then we are taking a certain carrier frequency FC1, and we are generating a first double sideband suppressed carrier modulated wave. Now we have to choose a first band pass filter stage, and then we have to generate a signal V2T. So now we try to see that, let us suppose we are having a message signal, okay, whose spectrum is something like this, okay, whose spectrum is varying from 0.3 to 3.4 kilohertz. So now again it is the message signal only, okay, voice message signal. So this is our spectrum. So this spectrum is of MT. So now once you multiply the carrier frequency, so let us suppose that ultimately we want a certain frequency, for example, either 1 megahertz or 5 megahertz, whatever carrier frequency is you want. But let us suppose we are not directly using that particular carrier frequency. What we are doing is, let us say that our carrier frequency at this moment is FC1 is equals to 50 kilohertz. Let us suppose. So if we are taking FC1 equals to 50 kilohertz, then what will happen is, because of this carrier frequency, the spectrum of the MT will be going to be shifted around 50 kilohertz. So now what we can see is, we can see DSBSC signal here, the spectrum of V2F is plotted. Okay, you see, after having the band pass filter of appropriate pass band, okay, we are going to get the V2T as a signal. And here I have plotted the spectrum of the V2T, frequency spectrum of the V2T. So now you can just see that basically when we take the carrier frequency equals to FC1 equals to 50 kilohertz, you can see that this spectrum is going to be shifted around 50 kilohertz. So let us say this is our 50 kilohertz point, and this will be our upper sideband. So that will become at 50.3, and this will come at 53.4. Similarly, a lower sideband will also come. Okay, a lower side band will also come, and that will again have a certain spectrum at this point. But if you see, if you want to reject one of the sideband, and if you just want to select the upper sideband, you try to understand that what will be the central frequency for rejecting the lower sideband. If you just want to design a filter just to pass the upper sideband, okay, what will be the like transition band that will be required for designing a band pass filter? So let us say that if this is the upper sideband that we wanted to filter out, means we want to pass and we want to remove the other lower sideband, then a filter should be required whose central frequency would be around somewhere 51 kilohertz. Okay, so if you calculate the central frequency of this filter, okay, that will be around 51.55 kilohertz. You can do this calculation, it is very easy to do. Okay, so you try to calculate the central frequency of the filter when we are choosing the carrier frequency equals to 50 kilohertz, that will be equals to 51.55 kilohertz. So the required minimum transition band for band pass filter one, okay, for this filter with 1% scheme, what we are going to get is central frequency of the band pass filter one will be 51.55. So transition band, we will be getting 1% of this. That 1% we are getting as 515 hertz. So now you try to see that if you compare, in the last slide, we have seen that this was having the gap between the two sideband was around 600 hertz, right? So now the required minimum transition band is 515 hertz, which is lower than that, fine? So it means that when we are choosing the carrier as a low frequency, for example, 50 kilohertz in this particular case, then the central frequency will give you a transition band that will be less than 600 hertz. At that time, the filter designing will be possible. Okay, and that time the filter designing can be possible. So basically, this band pass filter one designing will be possible. And what we can do is we can just design a filter that will have its transition band less than 600 hertz, and therefore we can only select one of the sideband. I hope you must be able to follow what I am explaining here. Okay, so what I am saying right now is, if you see the previous slide, if this is our upper sideband, and let us suppose this frequency was 50 kilohertz. So obviously that time only 515 hertz transition band is required. Okay, and the available transition band was 600 hertz. It means that we can only select one of the band, and the other band can completely be rejected. Okay, it can be easily rejected. Okay, why it is happening so? Because we are choosing the carrier frequency, at the first stage we are choosing the carrier frequency equals to 50 kilo, and therefore we are able to reject the one of the sideband, and we will be able to select the only one of the sideband. So once we are able to do this, okay, we have selected the V2T, generated the V2T, whose spectrum will be this. Now, if you see and if you compare, in the second stage, again, we are having the same product modulator. Okay, we just see this is one of the product modulator here, okay, in which we are generating the DSBSC signal. We are passing through an appropriate bandpass filter one. And after passing through the bandpass filter one, this V2T is now acting as a massive signal. Try to understand this. Okay, this will be acting as a massive signal. So now this will be our message. Instead of this, in the second stage, this particular spectrum will be considered as a massive signal. So now if you see here, the spectral null around the DC was available, and the bits between the two sideband was 600 hertz. Now if you see, what is the width? Okay, what is the gap between these two bands? Okay, so that is more than 100.6 kilohertz. You try to see this. This is 50.3. This is minus 50.3. So now this spectral null around the DC, its width has increased. Okay, its width has increased. So there is no frequency component in between minus 50.3 to plus 50.3. And therefore, there is a gap of huge width, like 100.3 kilohertz is available. So now, once we take this as a massive signal, V2T, at the second stage, now what we can do is we can choose any carrier frequency of our choice. For example, if you want to take 1 megahertz, if you take the 1 megahertz carrier frequency, this is going to shift it around 1 megahertz, this spectrum. And what will be the gap between the upper sideband and the lower sideband? That will be equals to 100.3 kilohertz. And we have already seen that if we are choosing 1 megahertz as the carrier frequency, what is the transition band that we require? The transition band required is 10.017 kilohertz. Okay, so transition band requirement can be met and the filter can be designed. Okay, similarly, even if you increase it 5 megahertz, still you will be getting its central frequency maybe 5 times greater than that. So it will be around 50 kilohertz. Okay, and still this gap is more than sufficient to design the filter. So basically, at this stage, V3T, we are going to get this type of spectrum based on the value of our carrier frequency FC2, whatever you want to take. And because there is a huge gap between the two bands, okay, between the two bands, one of the band can easily reject it because the filter designing implication has removed. Okay, so this is how we can generate the SSBSC generated SSBSC signal by using the frequency discrimination method. Generally, we do follow the two-stage generation because single-stage generation would not be sufficient because of the designing implication of the bandpass filter. So try to remember this point. This is a very important point. Fine. So I hope this must be clear how to design, generate the SSBSC signal using the frequency discrimination method. Now we have to look at the another method, which is our phase discrimination method. Okay. So in the frequency discrimination method, what we did, as we can see, that we are generally discriminating or rejecting or selecting the any appropriate or a particular band of frequencies based on our requirement. Okay, so basically it is eliminating or selecting a range of frequencies. Okay, so we are discriminating the signal based on the frequency. Okay, and therefore we are selecting one of the particular band like USB or LSB. So in the other method, we are having a phase discrimination method. Okay, phase discrimination method. So how to do that? So we have already seen its basic equation of the Masses signal, like SSBSS signal, okay, time domain waveform. So just by following that particular waveform, this phase discrimination method is designed. Okay, so how it can be done? We have to take the Masses signal, then this Masses signal has to be multiplied with one of the carrier. As we know that how, what is the time domain expression? If you remember, it is something like AC, MT, cos, omega, CT, then minus, plus, or plus, minus, then again, AC, M, cap, T, and sine omega, CT. Okay, that is the form of our SSBSS signal. So here you can see basically what we have to do is we have to take a Masses signal, and then this Masses signal has to be multiplied with the carrier AC cos omega CT. Okay, and then there will be a circuit that will be producing the Hilbert transform of the Masses signal. So let us suppose if we have MT, then there will be a network of circuits. Okay, some circuits will be available that will be able to generate the Hilbert transform, means 90 degree phase shifted version of the original Masses signal. So that will be giving you M cap T. And now we have to take one more 90 degree phase shifter to generate a quadrature carrier. So here we are taking AC cos omega CT. Then again, we will be taking AC sine omega CT. So now again, these two will be multiplied and then it will be added or subtracted based on the what kind of modulated signal we want to generate. For example, we are taking positive sign if we are LSB modulated. If it is negative, then it will be upper sideband modulated. So appropriate sign has to be chosen and then we can generate the Masses signal. Now you try to understand that though it is looks simple, okay, very simple method, but what is the problem? The problem is that if we are having a Masses signal MT, which is a multi-tone signal. Let us say if we want to talk about the voice signal, then the voice signal is containing frequency right from 300 Hertz to 3.4 kilohertz. So this Hilbert transform has to produce 90 degree phase shift for each and every frequency in a given band. It means that for 300 Hertz, or if it is 3.4 kilohertz, it has to be able to produce 90 degree phase shift for all the frequency component. So the meaning is we need to have a Hilbert transform that will be a wide band 90 degree phase shifter. Okay, it should be a wide band 90 degree phase shifter. So for all the frequency component, if suppose if you want to generate a SSBSS signal, yes, one more thing that I want to discuss, okay, about the frequency discrimination method. I will tell you, just let me finish this one. I will be telling you that one. So basically, if we want to generate the Hilbert transform of a Masses signal for the entire range of frequency of interest, this Hilbert transform should be able to generate a 90 degree phase shift. And generally, designing such network is very difficult. Okay, it is a practical difficulty. You remember that we cannot make such circuit that will be always giving you 90 degree phase shift for all the frequency range, because we know that the phase shift will be a function of the frequency. So as we are changing the frequency, either the phase shift will increase or decrease. Okay, the phase shift either increase or decrease because it will depend on the frequency. Okay, so it cannot remain constant for each and every frequency, and it cannot give you minus 90 degree for all the frequency component. So designing of the wideband minus 90 degree or 90 degree phase shifter is very difficult, and therefore generally this type of arrangements are not considered for generation of the SSBSS signal. Now there is an alternate arrangement. So what we do is again this section is remain same, this section remains same, this section will remain same, just to avoid this difficulty. Okay, because we have just taken one single circuit that will be able to generate the 90 degree phase shift. Here what we are doing is we are taking two phase shifting networks. Okay, one in the upper half and second one is the lower half. Okay, the idea is that as we know that we have to generate a 90 degree phase shift between these two signals. Here it is MT, here it is MCAPT. So what does it mean? There should be a 90 degree phase shift between MT and MCAPT. Okay, this is the idea. So basically what we are doing is we are taking two different phase shifting networks such that when we have a message signal like V3T here and here it is V4T, whenever we are getting a version of MT, if you calculate the phase difference between the MT which will be available at V3T and the MT that will be available at V4T, the phase difference will remain 90 degrees. Okay, if even if we are able to do that, we will be able to generate the SSBS signal. So what is the idea you try to understand with this mathematics? So let us suppose if we are having a phase shifting network one, whose phase response will be like this, okay? Whose phase response will be something like this. So H1F is its frequency response, okay? So it will be having unit magnitude and it's e to the power j theta 1F. So let us suppose that the frequency shifting network one is giving you theta 1F phase shift in the signal at frequency F. Okay, similarly, H2F is the frequency response of our phase shifting network 2, and it is giving us the frequency shift, phase shift is equals to theta 2F. Okay, so theta 2F and theta 1F are the phase shifting or phase shift provided by the phase shifting network 1 and phase shifting network 2 respectively. And it is obviously the like function of the frequency. Okay, when we change this frequency, theta 1F will change and again theta 2F will also change. But what we have to ensure that even if there is a change, but theta 1F minus theta 2F should always be equals to pi by 2. This is what the crucial thing that we have to maintain. We have to maintain that the theta 1F at any frequency, theta 1F minus theta 2F will be should be equals to pi by 2, that we have to maintain while designing this particular network. Fine. So let us suppose if MT is a multi-tone signal, this particular equation has to be followed, okay, always for all the frequency component, and therefore we will be able to generate the SSBS signal. Now just for the simplification, if we consider that MT as a single tone case, okay, let us say that the MT is any signal like AM cos omega MCT, okay. So then what will happen if we are considering MT equals to AM cos omega CT, omega MT, then after passing through the this particular phase shifting network one, the signal V1T will be equals to AM cos omega MT plus theta one, because it is shifting the mass signal by phase of theta one. Okay, so it is producing force, phase shift of theta one. Okay, so V1T will be nothing but AM cos omega MT plus theta 1. Similarly, you can calculate V2T. So V2T will be equals to cos omega MT plus theta 2. Okay, here. Then again, we have to multiply these two signal with the corresponding carrier, AC cos omega CT and AC sin omega CT. So once you will do that, we will be able to get this equation. V3T will be AM AC cos omega MT plus theta 1 cos omega CT. And then V4T will be AM AC cos omega MT plus theta 2 sin omega CT. So now when we are considering this single tone modulation, then what we can do is we will be considering that theta 1F at F equals to FM, let us say it is giving you theta 1 value. Okay, the phase shift is constant phase shift and that will be equals to theta 1. And that's why we are writing here it is theta 1. Okay, similarly theta 2F at F equals to FM will be equals to theta 2. Okay, so basically based on that, theta 2 will be equals to pi by 2 plus theta 1. This condition has to be followed because we need to maintain the 90 degree phase shift between these two signals. Okay, from the upper arm and the lower arm. So that we have to maintain. So basically we will be using this one. So V4T can be written as EM AC cos omega MT plus theta 1 plus pi by 2 sin omega CT. And then we can use the trigonometric identities. So that will be becoming minus sine omega MT plus theta 1. Okay. So now if we add this V3 and V4T, we will be able to show that this equation will be EM AC cos omega C plus omega MT plus theta 1. It means that it is going to give you upper sideband modulated signal when we are adding them. Similarly, if you subtract them, you may be able to get the lower sideband. So I hope this discussion must be clear, okay, how to generate the SSBSE signal using the phase discrimination method. So basically this alternate arrangement for phase discrimination method is popular. This is generally used because a single circuit cannot be able to generate the 90 degree phase shift for a wide range of frequencies. Now I just wanted to conclude with the frequency discrimination method. As I said that in the single stage generation or the double stage generation, in the two stage generation, I told you that I have taken the message signal as a voice signal. Is it possible to generate the SSBSE modulated signal for audio signal? So you try to do this, okay? Because if you see in the audio signal, there is a spectral null, but if you see that the spectral null will be very small, of 40 hertz. Okay, because we know that our audio signal is varying from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So a spectral null of width of 40 hertz will be available. And because that width is very small, it is very difficult to generate the SSBSE modulated signal for audio signals. You try to work out this one. Okay, you will find that it is very difficult because designing of the practical bandpass filter is not possible when we are considering the our audio signal as a message signal. That is not possible. So generally, SSBSE signal is basically used for transmission of the voice signals. Okay, there is no other application of the SSBSE signal you will find, because video signals is also having no spectral null around the DC. The only message signal which will be generated using the its SSB version can be generated is our voice signal. Okay, audio signal cannot be have its SSBSE version. So try to understand that and try to work out that. So I hope that this discussion must be clear. If you feel any doubt about this discussion, please drop your message in the comment box. So thank you for watching. I will be discussing some more topics in the coming lectures. So stay connected with the channel. If you have any query, please feel free to drop your message in the chat box. Thank you for watching. Stay connected with the channel for more updates. Thank you.